Friends, good morning. Thank you all for coming for the quality circle. This quality circle is called the 3-minute thesis competition, and I welcome you all for this competition. Just briefly, the 3-minute thesis competition is about presenting your MD, MS, or your MSc or PhD thesis, which you have done over many thousands of pages and words, to be able to summarize it in 3 minutes. Not only summarize it, you have to summarize it in a single slide, and you have 3 minutes to present it. So it's about conveying whatever you did, work you did, in 3 minutes. So it's about good research as well as being able to communicate it in a short time. So the rules of our competition, the presenter has only one slide. The slide won't have any animation or transitions, just one single slide. They can't have any sound or video files as part of the slide. There'll be no props. You can't come with any, you know, colorful uniform and anything else. The maximum is 3 minutes. So if they exceed 3 minutes, they are disqualified. So they have to finish within that 3 minutes time. And they have to only speak. There are no poems, raps, or songs. The presentations, the 3 minutes starts the moment they come on stage, and then they start their talk. And sometimes they just look at the audience, also the speech starts. And we have a judging panel, and I want to welcome them and thank them. Dr. J.P. Mulyal is our former principal, head of community health department. Thank you, sir. And second is Dr. Vikram Matthews, he's the professor and head of hematology department, and they're fully involved in research. And third is CU member, Dr. Satish, he's the professor of pediatric rheumatology. Thank you, Satish. Thank you all. So the judges will mark out of 10. We take an average, and the judge's decision is final. I won't go through all the judging criteria, but like I mentioned, the content of what they say will be half the marking. How did they tell you the significance? What did they tell you about the outcomes? Are they clear? How do they communicate in a simple language? And the other half of the mark is how they involve the audience, how much enthusiasm they have, how are they able to energize everybody here, and how clear they were. So there are marks just given for 2 things, content and communication. Just to put it a little bit, this is Dr. Prakash from biochemistry, who won in 2014. And this is Dr. Joshua Franklin from general surgery. It's not only basic science, it's also clinical, so anybody can win, so there's no biases. And I'll call upon Saibal Das to come. He has 10, 15 seconds to introduce himself and his guide, and then the presentation will... I'll do one thing, I forgot part of the show. Reverend Finney has to leave, so we'll have a short prayer, then we'll start.
Let's bow heads in prayer. God, our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this wonderful morning, for this new day. Thank you for your grace, your presence, your immense blessings upon us. We thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for the understanding, knowledge, skills that you have given us. Thank you for your great calling for us to continue in the ministry of healing. This morning, as we come together to learn from each other, we pray that you may bless this time. We pray for the presenters in this competition. We pray that you may bless them with your peace, with your understanding, help them to present their case clearly, that we may continue to understand more things. We pray for the judges, we pray for all of us who have gathered here. We thank you that fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Guide us and help us that we may be effective in your service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. I am Shoibal. I am a final year PG register from Department of Pharmacology. This project was done in the Clinical Pharmacology Unit under the guidance of Professor Denny Fleming and Professor Binu Matthew. Carbamazepine is a drug which is used in various neurological disorders. But for its marked pharmacokinetic variability, it requires therapeutic drug monitoring. For such therapeutic drug monitoring of carbamazepine, serum and plasma are the usual metrics which are used. But alternative metrics like saliva or dried blood spots are also used. In dried blood spots, a fixed amount of blood is spotted on a filter paper and is used for the assay. Previous workers have used some special expensive filter papers called Protein 7903 cards, which cost 105 rupees per card, and they have also used expensive methods like gas chromatography, mass spectroscopy for such dried blood spots assays. We wanted to see whether therapeutic drug monitoring of carbamazepine is accurate and reproducible using a simple Wattman filter paper which only costs rupees 5 per piece and using inexpensive methods. We also wanted to see whether concentration of carbamazepine in serum can be accurately predicted from that in dried blood spot. With these two objectives, we performed a prospective observational study. We fixed our sample size of 80 based on previous articles, and our power was 80% with 5% significance level. And we recruited 80 adult patients who were on chronic carbamazepine therapy from the epilepsy clinic. After obtaining informed consent, we collected blood from these patients. First, we measured carbamazepine concentration in serum, and then we measured carbamazepine concentration in dried blood spot. For dried blood spot, we spotted the blood in a Wattman filter paper, 20 microliters of blood, and we also performed a hematocrit correction. The whole assay was developed and validated using US FDA guidelines. After that, we randomly divided the data into two parts. The first part was used to develop a regression equation using Deming's regression, where the concentration of carbamazepine in serum can be obtained from that of dried blood spot. With the same regression equation, we validated our data using the remaining 40 patients, where we constructed a bland Altman plot. We found that the correlation between the predicted and the actual concentration was good, and the mean difference between these two were not much. Our assay was also good in terms of imprecision yield, extraction yield, imprecision and bias. The significance of this work is that rural hospitals and mission hospitals who do not have a lab facility but want to measure carbamazepine concentration can collect blood from these patients, can spot on a filter paper, and send to us after drying by a simple post, and we can do the assay and get back to them. So it significantly reduces the burden of the patient to travel the distance, it reduces the cost, it reduces the significant risk in transport of this blood sample, reducing biohazard, and we also check that our sample is stable in room temperature and outside for 28 days. We want to start this as a service for mission hospitals along with other anti-epileptic drugs. We want to thank the Institution Review Board and the patients included in this research. Thank you.
Good morning, all. My name is Riddhi, and I'm currently working in the Department of Endocrinology. I will be presenting my DM thesis done under the guidance of Dr. Nihal Thomas. I looked at the metabolic and genetic characteristics of patients with fibrocalculus pancreatic diabetes. When a Google search yields more than 150 million results for research studies in diabetes, how important is one more to our daily life? Well, extremely so. FCPD is a dangerous disease. Not only does it affect more than 10 lakh people in India, it causes severe fluctuations in blood glucose levels, insulin dependence, and death from hypoglycemia. Yet the hypothesis behind the pathophysiology is not well described. The objectives of our study were to look at the insulin resistance, insulin and glucagon secretion, body composition, fat metabolism, and SPINK1 gene mutations in a sample of 20 FCPD patients. The crux of our study lies in utilizing two novel methods for the first time ever in an Indian study. Pancreatic euglycemic hyperinsulinemic clamp, the gold standard to look at insulin resistance, and NMR spectroscopy to separately quantify the pancreatic, hepatic, intramyocellular, and extramyocellular fat. A pancreatic clamp is the only method which can give you both hepatic and peripheral insulin sensitivity. Throughout a 6-hour period, somatostatin is infused to suppress the endogenous pancreatic secretion. Along with that, there are stepped insulin secretions to drive the glucose into the periphery. The principle behind it is that a person with absolutely normal insulin sensitivity, the amount of glucose infused should be equal to the amount of glucose taken up. So any difference between these two is actually their insulin resistance. What did our study results show? Contrary to popular belief, significant hepatic and peripheral insulin resistance in FCPD once again for the first time in a study in FCPD. Not only that, despite extremely suppressed insulin levels, there is significant level of glucagon secretion which affects the insulin sensitivity. Coupled with that, there is significant reduction in fat levels at the pancreas, muscle, and liver. SPINK1 mutations up to the percentage of 66% predisposing an Indian subject to earlier onset diabetes and more severe insulin secretion. What does our study mean to a doctor, to a practitioner? Well, it has immense therapeutic implication. The fact that insulin resistance could contribute to FCPD means that it opens up the possibility of utilizing insulin sensitizers and glucagon antagonists like incretins in the management of FCPD, thus reducing death from hypoglycemia and providing a paradigm shift in the understanding of the pathogenesis and management of this disease. Thank you.
Good morning. I did my thesis under the guidance of Dr. Parthaprasad Chattopadhyay in All India Institute of Medical Science. Currently, I am working in the Department of Biochemistry as assistant professor. RNA interference employs double standard RNA for gene silencing. In our lab, they had designed siRNA targeting the promoter region of HIV genome so that it could inhibit the HIV in its ability to replicate and infect. So my aim of the study is to design a targeted drug delivery system so that these particular siRNAs can be delivered particularly to the HIV infected cells in order to avoid the untoward effect in bystander cells. So for that, I explored exosomes for this. Exosomes are basically endogenously produced nanoparticles. They measure in the range of 50 to 100 nanometer. So their biosynthesis involves two processes. The first step is, as you can see, the first step is invagination of these late endosomes to form multivesicular bodies. It has many many vesicles inside the lumen. So in the first step on invagination, it acquires some of its cytoplasmic content, which could be a protein or a lipid or a nucleic acid. Then in the second step, it fuses with the plasma membrane and releases its intraluminal vesicles as exosomes. The advantage of this second step is, on the process of fusing with the plasma membrane, it acquires some of membrane proteins present in the plasma membrane. So those plasma proteins will confer specificity for those exosomes to identify a target cell and deliver its cargo into a target cell. So that is what is employed. So here we developed a fusion gene, LAMP2B and RANTIS. Actually, as we all know, that HIV uses CCR5 as a co-receptor for its entry into the host cell. One of the known ligand for CCR5 is RANTIS. So we used this fusion, we constructed this fusion protein using overlap PCR. LAMP2B is generally assigned to be present in the membrane protein. It is supposed to be present in the membrane. So with the help of LAMP2B, this RANTIS will also be co-expressed on the membrane. So we transfected this particular construct in a eukaryotic expression vector and transfected into HeLa cells. HeLa cells are cervical carcinoma cells. So some of the HeLa cells express this fusion protein on the surface of the membrane, which means they are co-expressing RANTIS as well as LAMP2B. So we cultured these particular exosomes for 7 more days and collected cell culture supernatant from these things and isolated exosomes using ultracentrifugation technique. So we assume that some of the exosomes generated using generated from this HeLa cells would also harbor this fusion protein, so that they can be used for targeting potential. Our next strategy is to load these exosomes harboring the fusion protein with siRNAs so that they can be used for targeting potential. So I thank my guide and intramural grant of AIIMS for this study.
Good morning, everyone. I am Shiva Vyasam, doing my MD Pediatrics in CMC. I want to thank my guide, Dr. Satish Kumar, sir, who helped me in doing this thesis, and Vishalakshi, ma'am, for her important statistical analysis, which is a major crux for my study. SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus, is a multifactorial autoimmune disease which can present with great diversity of the clinical manifestations. The serological hallmark of the SLE is the presence of the autoantibodies which are directed against multiple nuclear, cytoplasmic, and the phospholipid components of the cell membranes. And some of these autoantibodies are used in the classification on the American College of Rheumatological Criteria for the SLE. Until now, in so many studies in the adults have shown the association between these autoantibodies and the clinical manifestations, and they told that autoantibodies tend to occur in the clusters, but which was lead to the new clinical associations. But until now, in pediatric SLE groups, there was only few studies which showed the association between the autoantibodies and the clinical manifestations, but none examining the antibody clustering. So we tried to look at this. Our aim is mainly to identify all the pediatric SLE patients with similar autoantibody patterns using the cluster analysis and to see the association between these autoantibodies and the clinical manifestations. So we included all the pediatric SLE patients who presented to our OPD between the June 2009 and December 2015 and who met American College of Rheumatological Criteria. And who met American College? We collected all the clinical manifestations and the autoantibody profile and we tried to note that all the documents. And depending on that, we tried to do cluster analysis and to see whether there is any association between the autoantibodies and the clinical manifestations. So we recruited total 212 pediatric SLE patients and we tried to see whether there is any association between the autoantibodies and the clinical manifestations. So we entered all the autoantibody profile and the clinical manifestations of the newly diagnosed patients and we entered in the epidata format and we tried to do k-mean cluster analysis and able to cluster them into three cluster groups based on the ECEX information criteria. And the cluster one is consists of mainly an ANA and the anti-DSDNA, which is associated with major organ involvement like lupus nephritis, CNS manifestations. Cluster two consists of anti-SM and anti-RNP, which associated predominantly with least renal and the neurological manifestations, which may be due to the anti-SM, which acts as a protective factor for the lupus nephritis. Whereas the cluster three consists of anti-SSC and the cardiolipin, which is associated with hair loss, serositis, and photosensitivity. So by doing this cluster analysis, we are able to cluster these autoantibodies into three cluster groups and helps in the identification of the clinical manifestation. So it is important, thus we can helps in the identification of the doing the complete autoantibody profile at the time of the diagnosis, can help in the predicting the clinical course of the pediatric SLE, and also helps in the identification of the patients at the risk of the major organ involvement. And this is one of the largest study done until now in India. Thank you.
Good morning, all of you. I'm Iron Dorothy, working in Community Health Nursing Department. I did this thesis under the guidance of Mrs. Rajeshwari Siva, Head of Community Health, and Dr. Rabin Choko, Head of Dental Unit. As we all know, diabetes is one of the common non-communicable disease contributing to the increasing mortality rate, mainly because of its complication. The complications are diabetic retinopathy, diabetic nephropathy, diabetic neuropathy, stroke, and cardiovascular disease. The sixth complication is periodontal disease, which is seldom talked about. Diabetes and periodontal disease have two-way relationship. Firstly, periodontal disease are more common in diabetic than non-diabetic because of persistent poor glycemic control and poor oral hygiene. Secondly, it is very difficult to control sugars in patients who have already developed periodontal disease because of either the choice of food or because of the infection. As a community health nurse, I meet a lot of patients with diabetes mellitus, and I talk about all the other complications, but not periodontal disease. I understand the awareness among the patients and among the health personnel was low. And my thesis topic was prevalence of oral problem among clients with type 2 diabetes mellitus, and to see the effectiveness of video-assisted teaching on knowledge, attitude, and practice regarding oral care among the type 2 diabetes mellitus. This study was conducted among 150 samples in the selected urban area of Vellore district, and I found that the prevalence of periodontal disease was 64.7% and the other oral problems was 35.3%, which was inconsistent with the other research findings too. And this was also associated with poor glycemic control and poor oral hygiene, which was statistically significant with a p-value of less than 0.05. I also was interested to find out the knowledge, attitude and practice, because it was surprising to me that 72% of the subjects said that they had no oral problems in spite of them having calculus, missing tooth, either partial or complete edentulous. And as I assessed their knowledge, attitude and practice using a questionnaire, I found it was very low. Video assisted teaching was given on oral care and importance of periodic dental checkup, and I found that there was a significant improvement in their knowledge, attitude and practice after the video assisted teaching, which was shown by the p-value less than 0.01, which was statistically significant. Hence, I recommend that the oral care has to be part of general practice, even as we see patients in the clinical area, both health personnel and others should mention about oral care, which would help them bring down the glucose level and bring about a beautiful smile on them. Thank you.
I'm Naveen from Bioengineering.
Doing my MS under the guidance of Dr. Shiva, Dr. Suresh, Dr. George Tharian, and Dr. Judina. Okay, imagine yourself to be an electronic system where the brain is the central control and you have the upper motor neuron and the lower motor neuron connecting your brain to the distal muscles forming a circuit. Suppose if I cut one of these wires, your circuit is interrupted and you will face functional disabilities. Drop foot is one such functional disability that is found in stroke patients, where the patient is not able to swing, the patient is not able to dorsiflex his foot during the swing phase. Instead, the patient will be dragging the foot over the floor during the swing phase for foot clearance. So what could be the solution? Just rewire this broken circuit by bypassing it through an external circuit where intervention is used as the electric current. The electric current is given to the nerves, to the peripheral nerves, which innervates these dorsiflexor muscles responsible for the dorsiflexion and thus regain the lost functionality, and hence the name functional electrical stimulation, which I'll be using for correcting the drop foot in stroke patients. So what's so special about my thesis? First, it's going to be cost-effective system compared to the 4.5 lakh machine that is available. And secondly, my system will have two modes. One will be the manual mode, that is manually stimulate during the swing phase, and second will be the automatic mode. Now, how am I implementing the automatic mode? I'll be giving my device to you. You'll fit it. I'll ask you to walk and manually stimulate during the swing phase. You'll do that. And during this walking procedure, my control unit will be asked to collect two types of data. One is the stimulation timing, when are you stimulating, and second, gate phase at which you stimulate. So I'll have two things that is collected in my PC through the Bluetooth. Now, I'll again reprogram that controller telling that, okay, fine. Now, based on the gate phase, stimulate back. The reverse logic, which will automate my system. So it's basically teaching my system from the manual stimulation, and that's what automatic foot drop correction is all about. Now the entire accuracy depends upon the two sensors that gives the gate phase. The two are on tibia and the foot. And to calibrate the system, I have used a double pendulum, because it's like a tibia and a foot forming the double pendulum. And if the angle measured by electronic potentiometer is the same as that measured by my sensor, it means it's calibrated. And the results show it's calibrated, which means the system is accurate. And there is hope of using the same thing for automatic foot drop correction. And the results are these, which can be used for automation. There is correlation. That's all. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, judges. I'm Dr. Santosh from the Department of General Medicine. I'll be presenting my PG dissertation. I did it under the guidance of Dr. Reginald Alex and Dr. Anthony Sami from Biostatistics, and also Dr. Henry from SSHS. So this slide pretty much sums up the concept and the idea behind my thesis. So God has made certain things to be in a certain way. The day to be active and work, and the night to sleep. The circadian rhythm set by the hypothalamus functions in such a way that we have different levels of functioning at different time of the day. With industrialization, modernization, advancement, development, we've set it all pretty wrong. So we work all day and night to cater for the needs of the growing society. So Dr. Reginald Alex and I had a hypothesis that rotating shift work had ill effect on health. We specifically wanted to look at metabolic syndrome because it was a predictor of other serious metabolic outcomes such as cardiovascular death and cerebrovascular accidents. So we chose the CMC staff. We did a study among the shift working and the daytime working group. We chose a study samples by systematic random sampling. They were chosen proportionately from their designations, and we had looked at all the important parameters which we thought might affect the outcome of metabolic syndrome, such as stress, diet, sleep, exercise, and of course the parameters which were needed for the diagnosis of metabolic syndrome. At the collection of baseline characteristics, what we had found that was most of the parameters between the two groups, the daytime workers and the shift workers, were more or less similar, except for three important characteristics. One, which is the age of the daytime workers were higher by 6 years on a mean, and two, the physical activity level was much higher in the shift workers, and three, the sleep of course was much better in the daytime workers. Going on to the results, what we had found is that the prevalence of metabolic syndrome in our study sample was 33.1%, that is 1 in 3 of the study population. And daytime workers had 41% prevalence of metabolic syndrome, and the shift workers had 25% metabolic syndrome. Yes, you heard me right. The daytime workers had more metabolic syndrome compared to the shift workers. But I would like to draw your attention to the fact that we had important baseline characteristics such as age and physical activity which were favoring the shift workers at the beginning of the study. So we did the multiple logistic regression, and at the end of multiple logistic regression we found out that there was no statistical significance, not just for metabolic syndrome but for all the other parameters that we had studied. So the only information that we have is 1 in 3 of our staff have metabolic syndrome, and the only preventable risk factor that was identified was increased physical activity. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Dr. Anupama, final year registrar in transfusion medicine. I did this thesis under the guidance of Dr. Dolly Daniel in our department, and with the cooperation from cardiothoracic department, Dr. Rai Tangachan and Dr. Raj Sajanandan. Thanks for Dr. Sukesh, who helped a lot. Imagine if your heart stops pumping and some hands start manipulating it. This is exactly what happens in a cardiac surgery. A cardiac surgeon needs a non-pumping blood-free heart to do his job. So, to whom does the heart outsource its function? There comes the cardiopulmonary bypass technology, also called the heart-lung machine. The blood is drained out of the heart and fed into this machine so that the heart can be given rest for some time and repaired. Agreed, it does some hearts and lungs function. But what else does this machine do to the blood? Heparinized blood, when exposed to wound and the surface of the extracorporeal system, undergoes a lot of calamities, changes like activation of the factors, activation of platelets, dysfunction, and leukocyte activation, fibrinolysis, all these things. Finally, it creates a mess in the blood so that the patient is under a hemostatic compromised state after the bypass surgery. So in this study, we aim to better understand the dynamics of cardiopulmonary bypass technology so that we can predict simple predictors for bleeding in the post-bypass surgery patient, so that the surgical and the transfusion teams can be ready with apt and correct treatment measures at the end of the surgery. 112 patients from the cardiothoracic surgery department who underwent open heart and pump surgery were recruited for the study, excluding children and cyanotics. Basic hemostatic parameters like hemoglobin, platelet count, prothrombin time, activated partial thromboplastin time, fibrinogen, and the rotational thromboelastometry were considered as the variables of importance. And the transfusions received and the postoperative bleeding, that is the bag above and the bag below, were considered as the outcomes of importance. And what we got to know is, concerned with the postoperative bleeding at the end of 24 hours, it is the male gender And the diagnosis of coronary artery disease, usage of antiplatelet drugs, and the post-bypass, immediate post-bypass after protamine reversal, the maximum clot firmness, these parameters were highly statistically significant in association with an increased post-operative bleeding. Other significant parameters are mentioned over here. Coming to transfusions, clot formation time and alpha angle, putting together the function of fibrinogen and platelets were important. So it is recommended that in the immediate post-bypass time frame after the protamine reversal, monitoring these parameters will help a lot to avoid unnecessary transfusions and to suggest correct products so that the coagulopathy can be corrected at that point so that it does not worsen and demand more products. We do care for the heart, not as dramatic and as direct as the surgeon, but a lot behind the scenes with caring, compassion, and precision. Thank you.
I am Ebenezer Rajdurai from the Department of Medicine. My thesis was surveillance of device-associated hospital-acquired infections. My guide was Dr. Ramya ma'am. I'd like to thank her. I'd also like to thank the organizers for the opportunity. I have titled my presentation, The Rise of Bugs. The Terminator device is Rise of Bugs. Imagine the sickest among us in the worst of times in ICU have being attacked by bugs. Bugs which use the best of our devices, the endotracheal tube, the central line, and the urinary catheter through which we are trying to save the patients. And this causes us to have the worst of the calamities in ICU. So my study, in my thesis, I looked at the incidence of the device-associated infections. I studied about 287 patients over a span of 4 months in ICU. About 1,200 device days were studied for each of the particular devices. It was an observational study. In my study, I found that the incidence of ventilator-associated event was 41 per 1,000 device days. It was important. It was important because when compared to developed nations, the incidence is about 10 times more. And what's more interesting is among countries, that is developed and developing countries, using the same criteria. I use the new CDC NHSN criteria, which avoids the human error. It is purely an objective criteria. It was found that in the United States, the incidence is 10 times less than us, and the common organisms in the United States were gram-positive organisms, Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, more than Pseudomonas, whereas in my study I found that it was gram-negative organisms, more of Acinetobacter. And the worrying part of that was that most of the organisms were resistant to first-line antibiotics. The scenario was no different in centraline-associated bloodstream infection. Here again, the incidence was 6.6 per 1,000 device days, which is about 3 times more than what it was in the United States using the same criteria, and most of the organisms were gram-negative when compared to developed countries where the organisms were gram-positive. The incidence of catheter-associated urinary infection was 2.87, twice more than developed nations, and most of the organisms were gram-negative. So at the end of the study, I found that the bugs have become more resistant, resilient, and have risen against us. So we need to use the age-old technique which has been proven time and again to be helpful, hand washing and personal protection equipment, to prevent patient-to-patient and patient-to-doctor and subsequently patient carriage of infections, thereby win the battle against the bugs even as we continue the war against them. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Myself, Dr. Tanai, working as a PG registrar in the Department of Psychiatry. Before joining here, I did my DNB Psychiatry from WIMANS, Vidyasagar Institute of Mental Health from New Delhi. So I'm presenting the DNB thesis here. I'll thank the organization for giving me the opportunity. As the world of psychiatry, to be in a broader sense, mental health is different, and our search and our goal are little different from the accurate and complete medical background. In the search of appropriate evidence-based and effective management of the psychiatric disorder, the constant research is going on both nationally and internationally to underpin both the biological and social factors. The word both biological and social factors is extremely important as the psychosocial stresses changes the prognosis codes and the management options completely differently. Here comes the option of pathways of care, which was defined as sequence of contacts with individuals or organization initiated by the patient himself or the significant others to seek for appropriate help. The concept came in 1976 by David Goldberg under a WHO project. We continued in a naturalistic observational study in a tertiary care center in Delhi, in Vimans, with the purpose to provide early engagement to psychiatric service and minimize the effective cost of the treatment and maximize the better prognosis. With this aim, we kept a specific objective to study the socio-demographic profile and clinical profile of the patients and to identify the different service provider approached by the patient themselves. In methodology, we included 185 patients, both from OPD and IPD, with the inclusion criteria of first admission with any psychiatric diagnosis and no other comorbidity. After meeting the other exclusion criteria, we completed a study with 151 of patients using the tools of semi-structural questionnaires, MINI, along with the pathways of care of WHO, with descriptive statistics and using the categorical variable and metric variables both. In result, we found the most help-seeking people are male, around 67%, from an urban background, nearly 90%, with a complaint. They generally presented with a complaint of aggressive behavior up to 17%. The reason for admission has came, which generally happens for aggression for up to 51%, and for accessing a proper psychiatric care, the service provider before accessing a proper psychiatric care went up to 8 psychiatric service carer in some cases. Maximum was 2 as per our population, which was for 33% of patients. With this, I'd like to conclude that the predominance of health seeking remained to be in urban people, mostly male, because of the social issues and economical issues. And they were also being brought early to the proper psychiatric care. Nuclear families has been observed to have the more emotional overburdens and more of neurosis. An interesting finding that general practitioners remained the first 33% of cases, they remained the first contact. So continued CME and the psychiatric care need to be important. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we'll have just 2 or 3 minutes where the judges will tally we'll have a tallying of the scores and then we'll announce the results. We have a wide range of speakers. Some of them are from basic science, some are from clinical medicine, and some are from allied and including nursing. So can we all give a hand to the real stars of today? It's wonderful to see that. Fantastic, well done. I want to give the vote of thanks first before announcing others. We'll forget to thank all people. I want to first thank our judges. Thank you to Dr. J.P. Mulyal, Dr. Vikram, and Dr. Satish. Shall we give them a hand also? Three-minute competition actually was initially set up by the University of Queensland, so we're supposed to acknowledge them that these are the rules and regulations they have set. What happens next is the judges will tally the first, second, and third prize, and then we will hand over the prizes to them. While they are doing that, we have a few minutes for audience questions. If any of the audience would like to ask any questions of our presenters, they were not, that was not part of the plan, but we have a few minutes if anybody would like to ask any questions to the audience, I mean to the presenters, on what they have done. We have a few minutes. We also have a few minutes for comments from the judges about the presentation, or if there are any comments they would like to make. You don't have to, but.
Uh, I thoroughly enjoyed it, and I've never been in a situation like this. I was invited earlier for a program like this, and I chickened out. I remember being in a meeting where a Brazilian chairman was talking, listening to somebody from Australia talking, and said, "Sir, you say so many good things, but can you say it without using all those words?" Okay, that's what we had. You know, you minimize, concise, and be to the point. It was lovely. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Any audience questions to the speakers? Just 2 minutes and we'll have this course. Ask Dr. J.P. Mulyal to give away the prizes. Yes, sir. We'll start with the third prize, and I must say that everybody is a winner here. Thank you all for taking part. The third prize is Mr. Naveen. The second prize is Dr. Saibal Das. And the first prize, Dr. Riddhi Das Gupta. With that, we have actually come to the end of our program. Once again, thank you to the judges for taking 1 hour off. I want to thank the scorer, Gauri, also. Thank you to Mr. Alphonse and Mr. Madan, who organized. Thank you to our videographers. Thank you to the curriculum office, who actually set up all this, and for the distance people for the video also. Thank you. So thank you to the audience and the presenters once again. Thank you. See you next year.